First, we have Ola Abu Alghaib, who is the head of policy at the Leonard Cheshire Disability. Then we have got Silvana Corso, who is one of the Global Teacher Prize finalists from 2017, and is a history teacher, but has a specialism in considering educational adaptations and strategies for pupils with learning disorders. Then we've got John Patterson, who is the head teacher of St. Vincent's School and has a myriad of experiences with systemic leadership to support locality strategy. And we finally, on stage at the moment, have Cary Supalo, who is a research scientist at Purdue University. So the structure for this session is that each speaker will have up to 7 minutes to present their views. They will take it from a number of perspectives. We're keeping it broad because actually the topic here is quite global. We know that there is differing policy country to country, but we also need to bear in mind that we're trying to move towards a truly inclusive society. And what we have gathered here today are four colleagues who really will challenge what the current provision is and what we need to have in order to ensure all pupils are accessing a very important, purposeful education, not just one that includes them, but one that meets them at their point of learning and ensures that they are going to meet their fullest potential. At the end, we will have questions from the audience. Please, one of our speakers speaks in Spanish, so if you have not get it yet, please get a headset so that it is translated into English for you, if English is your first language, because she has a very important perspective we want to bring into this discussion today. Okay, so we're going to begin with Ola.
Yeah. Thank you, Chair. Thank you. Welcome, everybody. Your presence with us today proves your attention to the topic, which is very globally, as it was mentioned, to trying to answer the question of what is entailed for children with disabilities to be included in the Education for All agenda. We know that globally, since decades, this question has been emerging, but unfortunately, until now, we haven't reached a global consensus of what is entailed for inclusive classrooms to be inclusive to children with disabilities. We know that there are many global frameworks out there that are on paper committing to this agenda, starting since almost 11 years now with the Convention on Rights of Persons with Disabilities. On Article 24, it came and confirmed the rights of children with disabilities to be mainstreamed in public schools. It also articulated clearly what would that entail for governments to put in practice. We have seen also that in 2015, there was more and more global attention to children with disabilities in the Global Development Goals, which was also a great achievement, not just for children with disabilities, but also to the whole disability agenda. We have seen that there were clear indicators around disability, not just in the goal four, but across different goals. When it was discussed about equality, disability emerged as a key component, ensuring that no one is left behind by 2030. What I will do today is I will share with you insights from a recent research we have completed in four countries in Africa, where we looked across four thematic areas and education was one of them. It was Kenya, Zambia, Sierra Leone, and I forgot the fourth country. So in those four countries, we looked at what is considered as key barriers of bridging the gap when communities develop their socio-economical rights, why would disability is still not reaching the equal level of non-disabled peers in those communities. We did it through mixed methods. It was quantitative and qualitative research, and we interviewed 5,000 households. And the questions for families and children with disabilities, trying to understand the barriers of inclusion. One of the key findings that came across the four countries is that the majority of children with disabilities are either out of school or are in segregated schools. Unfortunately, it was striking to us that most of those countries, actually four of them, have ratified the convention, have showed commitment to the global agendas, but still children with disabilities are out of the system within the government commitment. What came as barriers, and it was articulated through the policy analysis, but also the feedbacks of parents, was the issue of inaccessibility to reach schools. Around 70% of children that were already in school at the beginning of the year where we did our research, dropped off school because they couldn't afford accessing the school, which was again striking that additional cost of disability has not been considered when designing inclusive education practices. Another key barrier for parents was the quality of education delivered in mainstream schools. 80% of families we interviewed had a preference to keep their children in segregated education systems, which was again striking to us. And when we tried to analyze further the reasons behind that, it was their concern that when some of those children were in mainstream school, yes, they were in the system, but they couldn't learn as their non-disabled peers. That's why families preferred to bring them out of the system and put them in special education settings. So that was another striking finding for us. The third one is that when we looked at financing systems in those four countries, we couldn't find systematic way where governments allocated funding to ensure there is a support system for children with disabilities. Additional to that, teacher assistance, which proved its effectiveness in many of the classrooms we worked in before, none of the ministries we worked with were very keen to adopt that policy because they were concerned they wouldn't meet the finance expectation of that. An additional barrier that came from the research was the issue around the absence of data of how many children are actually in school, because even though there are generation of data on disability on national census, but administrative data missed how many children are in or out of school within an annual period. And that was again a weakness for even the disability organizations to put governments into account saying you are failing children with disabilities. So that's something came out as a recommendation from our research trying to ensure there are the right monitoring mechanisms in place. Data needs to be available, not just for policymakers, but also for development actors and for advocacy organizations to ensure that there is improvement across the upcoming years around the issue. The final comment I would like to say is that within the practice, things proves its effectiveness. We have programs across 17 countries in Asia and Africa. With our available funding, we have managed, when supporting, for example, girls with disabilities access schooling, it worked very well. In Kenya, as an example, within a 3 years program that was funded by DFID, we have managed to improve the learning outcomes of girls with disabilities within 3 years from 20 to 60% in terms of literacy and numeracy. So that shows things can happen if there is a comprehensive approach to looking into inclusive practices in many countries. Thank you very much.
Next, we're going to have on this end, Cary Supalo from Purdue University. because we've gone into the policy perspective, and now Cary is going to share with us, as a research scientist, his perspective on this topic.
All right. Thank you very much, and it's a pleasure to be here this afternoon. Just for further disclosure, I do wear one other hat. Besides being a research scientist in the chemistry department at Purdue University, yes, I'm that chemistry professor people hate to love to hate. I can be, but also I work at the Educational Testing Service developing inclusive high-stakes assessments for students with disabilities. So between the assessment side and the research side, I can go either way. But very well. A little bit about my background. I am totally blind. I went blind when I was 7 years old. I went to bed one night and woke up the next day, couldn't see. It was a very non-traumatic, but yet a life-changing moment in my life, as you could imagine, having sight as a child to not having it. And I grew up as a sighted child. I could read and write, print. I could play sports and watch TV and things of that sort. But then my whole life changed. And yet I had lots of questions. And I wanted to know why things were the way they were in the world. And so my interest in math and science was adopted by me as a young child, and yet the disability did not discourage me from the path of pursuing a science profession. And I encountered many barriers along the way from the school system. In high school, in grade 11, I wanted to take calculus as a senior and grade 12 student, and I was told that no person with a visual impairment had taken calculus before. It had never been done, and if you choose that path, we cannot support you in that endeavor. And so as a result of that decision being made, I did not pursue that that course of study in high school. I ended up taking traditional mathematics, what was called business math, learning how to calculate taxes and balance a checkbook and things of that sort. But anyway.
We're going to pause for sure. 1 moment. Okay.
Hmm. That's too bad. Do you want me to? Should I skip the mic?
No, they've got a technical difficulty, so for translation and for sound as well.
Okay.
And if we could pause the clock, that would be great. Apologies, everybody.
All right, just tell me when to continue.
Actually, would you like to share, while we're waiting, we've got some added time, do you want to elaborate a bit more on your experiences?
Absolutely.
In trying to essentially, hopefully, challenge a barrier, which was your own school.
Sure, yes. You want me to continue on that?
Yeah.
Okay, sure. So, being that I had access to the calculus curriculum, I was encouraged to study psychology and business administration as a field of study in college, per my guidance counselor saying that no blind person had done calculus, so therefore you cannot be an engineer, which is what I wanted to be at the time. And so I graduated from high school, went off to post-secondary school, and learned very quickly, encountering other blind and visually impaired professionals in the United States, that blind people could be mathematicians and could be scientists and engineers, and so that inspired me. But not having access to a role model played a valuable role in my professional development as I progressed through college. And I went off to Purdue University, where I quickly became a chemistry major and encountered all kinds of barriers to accessing curriculum, as you can imagine. The visual nature of mathematical graphics, chemical concepts, and things of that sort. And there's no one right way to make science accessible to a student with a visual impairment. So it really takes creativity and fundamental problem-solving skills on site, and the student with the visual impairment working closely with the faculty to come up with ways to make content more accessible. And So that's how I did it. But remember, learning is individualized. And don't forget that, because how I learned science might be different from some students you may encounter in the future. And so working with the parents as well as the students as to what accommodations they will need is very, very useful information. Should I continue on the...
Yes, and okay. We've got about 4 minutes.
Very good, thank you. So that all being the premise for my research on my dissertation at Penn State University was to develop a suite of talking laboratory tools for students who are blind or visually impaired, and doing a field test in secondary school where we provided laboratory tools that talked and made beeping tones and things of that sort. And we wanted to see if there was more hands-on science engagement, learning going on. And we had a sample size of 15 students in the study over a 4-year period. And 14 of the 15 students in the research study demonstrated a positive shift in attitudes towards science after their the intervention had been made available to them. And approximately 50%, 7 out of the 15, went on to post-secondary education, declaring STEM and science-related majors, which I think is amazing, which is much higher than the typical percentages of students with disabilities, as you can imagine. And it reinforces the idea that when you give students the ability to do for themselves, hands-on science learning really does empower this marginalized population that they can do science. Now, my schooling, I had to work with sighted assistants through most of my secondary and post-secondary education, and that model, although effective in completing course requirements, can be viewed as a passive approach to learning and can discourage the overwhelming majority of students with visual impairments to want to be scientists, because it reinforces the idea that they cannot do this type of work. But I persevered and stayed on the path and went on and completed my PhD studies at Penn State University and went on to university as an assistant professor of chemistry, teaching general chemistry to sighted students. And that, I must say, was a really inspirational realization for me, because I was teaching laboratory work, and typically the student with the visual impairment, they say, who's gonna get so-and-so out of the lab? Who's gonna escort them out? Well, now I was responsible for making sure my students got out of the laboratory in case of an emergency, which did happen one day. With what I call an unauthorized fire was started in my laboratory, and I had to escort everyone out and make sure that they made it to safety. And how I did this was through verbal communication. I knew all of my students' names and voices. And, you know, there was an honor system. Why would you want to stay in a laboratory if it's on fire? Practicality aside. And when the fire marshals came to the chemistry building and asked what was going on in my classroom, they did not care that I could not see. They wanted to know what the science was going on and if it was safe to let people back in the building. And that's when you know you've really accomplished something significant, is when they overlook the disability and focus on the science. And that's one of my missions in my career going forward, is to create opportunities for students with visual impairments to have more access to educational opportunities that I have had. Through that work and my research in graduate school, it evolved in a whole line of talking laboratory tools, which are now commercially available, and you can find them online if you'd like. And we're distributing them all around the world now in schools, and I'm really hoping that the STEM education fields will become more accessible to students who are blind or visually impaired. Thank you very much.
Next, we're going to go to the perspective of a school leader. So we're with John Patterson, who is the head teacher of a school in Liverpool in England.
Thank you very much indeed. Good afternoon. I'll have to stand up, sorry. No, that was wonderful. Thank you so much, because, you know, you reflected really on individuality, and this is something that we always taught at St. Vincent says, you know, our children who are blind are just children who happen to be blind. So thank you for sharing that story. Thank you. You know, we're looking at how do we teach and how do we teach the teachers to teach, especially for us within that context of blind and visual impairments, VI. We know we can go anywhere in the world and ask visually impaired young people, what is it you want? And they will say the same two things, and I'm sure you'll agree with me. Employment and friendship groups. That is our challenge, those two, employment and friendship groups. Let's look back a little bit, though. The Organisation for Economic Cooperation and Development set a challenge. They wanted a formula to reconcile social cohesion with economic success. So today, I'm going to give you a formula, if I may, that actually impacts on those two statistics we're looking for, employment and friendship groups. It's up on the screen. When you engage social capital and human capital, by that I mean networks of neighbourhoods working with and for VI. Human capital, the strengths, the knowledge, skills and understanding, so beautifully illustrated just then, the strengths of visually impaired individual children. You stick that together with reverse inclusion. What's that? When we bring sighted children into St. Vincent's, where our children take the lead, something magical happens. You stick that together with service learning. Service learning is a particular form of volunteerism, and we bring in students from Liverpool Hope University, for instance, who are teacher training. What we do is we engage those in a creative project with our children. What you get when you mix that with a bit of creativity, that happens when you have that formula all mixed together, you get outcomes, employment, friendship groups. Now, I can talk about this from any impact case study you would like that our children have delivered. And I can do all the creative industries, but I'm going to music, art, and dance, and drama, and sport. I'm going to focus on sport, because this is my specialism whilst at Liverpool Hope. We engage lots of our children in as many sports as humanly possible. And you'd be surprised at how limited access to sports actually can be. But our children play sports and bring in sighted peers to play with them. Playing boccia, for instance. Boccia, bowls for the blind, is the best way to explain it, but it's not. It's boccia. Our children play sports. This is where their self-esteem, their belief in themselves, their mobility is all raised significantly. These are the soft outcomes. This is where you find our children's strengths, and we signpost their strengths into STEM, into the science and the tech and the engineering and the maths, to design ideas that can help themselves and their peers access sports. What we've done is we've focused it into a sight box. I can talk about this later, but a sight box is a physical box in which the children are putting their ideas. And we've been sending that physical box with the support of Rotary International to, mentioned this morning, Sierra Leone, India, Pakistan, Rwanda, Gambia, Malawi. This is an interesting point I'll come to in a minute. These outcomes are our children are sending their ideas around the world. And they're just at the first stages of teaching other blind children how to use the content remotely. What's happening is a whole buzz and vibe around technology and future thinking, i.e. when you engage visually impaired children with other students who are sighted, with student teachers, within STEM, they have their own ideas which we can generate, send around the world, and engage teaching and learning in a very different way, remotely. I would love you to have a look at that formula, and definitely you're not going to escape me, sir. I'd love you to look at that formula and try it with visually impaired children anywhere where you are, because we want to help you do that. Thank you for your time.
Our next speaker is Silvano Corso. Does everybody have a translating device? Because this is going to be delivered in Spanish. And actually, unfortunately, the speakers at the front do not. And we're going to be involved in questions. So is it possible to get four devices, please? Thank you so much. So as I mentioned, she was a Global Teacher Prize finalist, and thank you. As a outstanding teacher, she is also very much integrating the strategies and approaches that are necessary to ensure pupils with learning disorders are not restricted from the opportunities in learning.
Buenas tardes. En primer lugar, quiero destacar la coherencia de este panel hablando de atender a la diversidad y de inclusión. Me permiten hablar en mi idioma, por lo tanto me siento completamente incluida y por eso me siento agradecida. Mi nombre es Silvana Corso y yo soy directora de una escuela secundaria que depende del gobierno de la Ciudad de Buenos Aires. Una escuela que trabaja en términos de inclusión, que aloja a todos y cada uno de sus alumnos, que intenta dar respuesta a cada singularidad, cada presencia y cada necesidad. Pero antes de avanzar y compartir la experiencia de mi escuela, quería preguntarles...
Number two, we'll take it to English.
That would be helpful.
Thank you. Bueno, les decía que dirijo una escuela que trabaja en inclusión, pero antes de compartir esa experiencia, quería preguntarles si saben ¿qué es lo primero que le pasa a una persona que nace con discapacidad? ¿Saben qué es lo primero que les pasa? Pierden identidad. Ni bien nos enteramos que vamos a tener un hijo, lo primero que hacemos es imaginarlo y nombrarlo. Paradójicamente, cuando nace, lo primero que pierde es el nombre. La medicina reproduce lo que los espartanos hacían en el monte Taigeto, solo con el simple hecho de etiquetar. Y eso es fundamental, saberlo aquellos que trabajamos en educación, saber el recorrido y la historia de nuestros niños, de nuestras niñas, que empieza por su nombre. El nombre tiene historia y tiene prehistoria, y con eso nos tenemos que comprometer. Creo que es la pregunta correcta que debería hacerse la escuela es quién es. Y nosotros solemos reproducir lo que los espartanos, cuando preguntamos ante la presencia de un alumno con discapacidad, ¿qué tiene? Justamente ahí está la clave para poder hacer real la atención a la diversidad. Si nosotros queremos instalar en debate, ¿no?, y el tema de la inclusión, y si es posible, yo diría que la gran estrategia es preguntar quién es. La escuela tiene el poder de nombrar, de devolver identidad, diría hasta de devolver la condición de persona. Entonces, no debemos preguntarnos si es posible, sino descartar esto y preguntarnos cómo lo hacemos, ¿no? ¿Yo de dónde aprendí esto? ¿Por qué dirijo la escuela que dirijo hoy? Lo aprendí de mi hija, Catalina, que nació con una discapacidad severa. Y de ella aprendí todo lo que hoy puedo mostrarles a partir de este video, que es mi escuela.
Yo no voy a avergonzarme de estas lágrimas, ni callar mi corazón, ni rendirme en el perdón, porque es sincero lo que soy. No bajaré mi bandera. Cada paso y cada huella tuya es única. De la cabeza a los pies, cada uno es como es. Por eso déjame vivir. Yo elegiré la manera. Pienso seguir al borde del sol. Aunque digan lo que digan, yo soy más fuerte si me dicen no. A todos se nos quiebra la voz, en todos hay un poco de Dios. Yo soy igual a ti, tú eres igual a mí, y es uno solo el amor. Rescata de tu alma esa flor y olvidará su sexo y color. Yo soy igual a ti, tú eres igual a mí, y es uno solo el amor. Siempre más de una visión de la película, otros modos de mirar, muchas formas de escribir, y nadie tiene la verdad. Las voces son infinitas. No voy a cambiar la historia de esta América. Suena fuerte mi canción. Yo defiendo la razón, y no hay granada ni cañón que ahuyente a un hombre que grita. Pienso seguir al borde del sol.
Y hoy trabajamos con alumnos con trastorno del espectro autista, ADD, TGD. Trabajamos con alumnos con parálisis cerebral, mielomeningocele, espina bífida, hidrocefalia, incluso con alumnos con cuadros psiquiátricos como psicosis y esquizofrenia. A esto les puedo agregar que estamos en un contexto de pobreza, trabajando con un barrio que está en riesgo, un barrio conocido allá en la Argentina popularmente como Fuerte Apache, así que además trabajamos con alumnas madres, padres, embarazadas, con los bebés, alumnos judicializados. Es decir, una escuela que atiende a todos, ¿no? Y además estamos nosotros, decimos, así que es perfecta, es una escuela que atiende a la diversidad. ¿Cómo lo hacemos? Con la convicción que todos los alumnos pueden aprender. Creemos que todos los alumnos pueden aprender y derribamos la principal barrera para hacer real la inclusión. ¿Y saben cuál es? La representación social del otro. El otro es simplemente otro y por serlo nos complementa, enriquece nuestra vida. Derribamos esa barrera, naturalizamos la presencia de todos y trabajamos fundamentalmente derribando tres discursos que sostenemos los docentes solo para justificar nuestras prácticas. Sin recursos no se puede, sin formación no se puede y si el sistema no cambia no se puede. Los tiempos del sistema no son los tiempos de los chicos y muchos de ellos mueren literalmente esperando que el sistema cambie. Entonces tenemos una responsabilidad moral de avanzar más allá de las políticas públicas. De recursos, aprendí que los más importantes dentro de una escuela son los recursos humanos. Son los únicos de los que no podemos prescindir. Y de eso los argentinos podemos dar cuenta por nuestra creatividad al hacer real nuestro estar en la escuela. Y por otro lado, sin formación, debemos admitir como docentes que siempre estamos carentes de formación, que estamos obligados por ética profesional a la formación permanente, a la formación continua. Si yo tendría que decir, y para sintetizar, cuáles serían los desafíos de cara al 2030, tendría que decir que, y como dije inicialmente, el principal desafío es desinstalar el discurso de si es posible o no la inclusión e instalar un nuevo discurso que es cómo lo hacemos. Generar en estos espacios una red donde vamos a compartir las estrategias para hacerlo real. No podemos discutir si pueden o no pueden estar en la escuela. Todos los niños dentro de la escuela, porque la escuela tiene no solo el poder de nombrar y devolver identidad. ¿Saben el poder que tiene la escuela? Es transformar la sociedad. Queremos una sociedad que sea inclusiva, una sociedad solidaria, empática. Bueno, el cambio sería naturalizar a todos dentro de la escuela, que todos estén dentro de la escuela y el día de mañana, en el 2030, podríamos celebrar una escuela diferente. Y creo que trabajar en inclusión, y cierro con esto, es una oportunidad única y más que un desafío, es una oportunidad de crecimiento profesional, pero fundamentalmente de crecimiento como personas. Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much to all four of our presenters. What we'll do now is for the next 20 minutes, we'll have questions from the audience. You've got this expert advisory group to support your questions and queries. Is there anybody who has a question? On a hotly debated topic. Inclusion is a very complex concept. I could maybe start with one. We were trying to explore what could be done to ensure pupils with special educational needs and or disabilities can access a more purposeful education. Does anybody in the group feel that there is something that is going to be the first step towards this?
May I suggest?
Yes.
May I suggest something, colleagues? I mentioned a site box earlier, and it is a collection of materials that enable children to access sports and friendship groups and start the first step of understanding STEM. Now, Rotary are supporting us by these, so if anybody's got a school for the visually impaired that they know of anywhere in the world, we're happy to send one of these to that school. Maybe that's a step that we could all collaborate on, a research piece, a longitudinal piece, and really see the impact of what this can do for visually impaired children as they design brilliant ideas that we were talking on before. So, colleagues, it's an offer for some of the site boxes to visually impaired schools, please.
Thank you, John. Gentleman at the front. Yes.
Bueno, mi nombre es Germán, yo soy de Argentina. Mi pregunta, trabajo en una escuela técnica.
Can you translate?
My name is Germán and I work in the school of...
Bueno. Sí, mi nombre es Germán, soy de Argentina, trabajo en una escuela técnica en la cual trabajamos con máquinas con riesgo, que tienen riesgo para la seguridad física de cualquier estudiante. Y estamos preparándonos para el desafío de integrar, de incluir algún estudiante que venga con algún tipo de discapacidad en el cual no sabemos cómo abordarlo. No estamos preparados como para abordarlo, para que si puedan cortar una madera en una sierra, trabajar con electricidad y varias actividades que tienen, que implican un riesgo de ese tipo. Un poco, digamos, él que trajo con su experiencia, ¿no es cierto?, que se transformó en químico, ¿qué pueden sugerirnos? Porque, digamos, es un... al 2030... las escuelas especiales tienen que desaparecer. O sea, deben estar integradas en una sola, como justamente estaba diciendo Silvana, ¿cómo lo hacemos? Ya no podemos decir, no se puede. Eso.
Yeah. So, Cary, did you want to answer that question?
I would like to make a comment on that. For students that are visually impaired, a big part of accommodation is methodological in nature, both for how the content is rendered to the student, but also how the student works and their spatial awareness. Oh, that's that. Sorry about that. Their spatial awareness, yeah, of their surroundings. And so it's important to give them the opportunity to examine equipment before hazardous materials are provided for them to use, to feel what a beaker feels like or a test tube. Okay, typically I recommend this type of instruction happens before a course begins, and that all students, not just the visually impaired or the students with disabilities, are fully aware of the risks involved with the materials they're working with. In my graduate research, I've handled materials that one drop gets on my skin, I would literally die. And having the self-confidence in my skill set to handle that type of a risk, I would do it again in a second, okay? But you've got to know what you're doing. And the teachers need to know how to promote inclusion in the science laboratory, okay? A lot of their professional training does not cover this topic.
So it'll require them to research through published literature or online what types of techniques are available for them to do that. But it is definitely doable. It's just a matter of fundamental problem solving in the classroom, both on the student side, but also on the teacher side.
Thank you. And Ola, did you want to make a comment as well?
Yeah, of course. I think there are different levels for consideration. Of course, as it was discussed by my colleague, there is the issue of accommodation in the environment. So when we're talking about students with disabilities, we need to understand that there are different types of disabilities. So your choice of whether you want to be inclusive to all students, then you need to understand what entails for students with physical disabilities, because it's going to be different from students with visual impairment, students with hearing impairment. So that's very important to take into consideration. The other one that is equally important is the teacher training, because the more the teachers are aware about the communication etiquettes with students with disabilities, that's a key one as well. It's not just about comprehension of the training materials, but it's also the understanding about barriers of communication for students with disabilities. And the third one, I would say, is creating a system where those students have a voice in school. And I want to stress so much on the importance of this one. From experience, the peer-to-peer groups that we have created in many of our programs showed effectiveness because students tend to be more open to talk to their colleagues than teachers about what's working and what's not in the school. So creating those groups, having a very effective mechanism between the students and the teachers to understand what is existing as barriers can definitely help you in assuring that your program is inclusive to all and where are the areas that you need to constantly consider adapting as you are implementing. I hope that is useful.
Thank you. Was there another question? Yes?
It's a question for Signora Corso. Some translation. Can you give examples of how you get people to find their own identity, their own voice? You're saying the importance of connecting to their own inner voice, their own identity, their inner being.
En la escuela nosotros trabajamos fundamentalmente con el vínculo. Trabajamos con los docentes en un espacio de formación permanente y si bien hacemos capacitación en relación a las estrategias para incluir metodológicas, primero trabajamos el reconocimiento del otro y la empatía. Y de esa manera ellos pueden llegar al aula y vincularse con los alumnos a la hora de generar un espacio que aloje, y en este sentido estoy hablando, no somos la familia, pero el ámbito se torna familiar, los alumnos se sienten empoderados. Solo con el hecho de atravesar la puerta de la escuela y que cada uno sea llamado por su nombre. Pero para esto nosotros tuvimos que trabajar muy fuertemente con los docentes. Y como lo hicimos, traemos a la escuela en el espacio de capacitación personas con discapacidad adultas que pueden transmitir sus vivencias y darles incluso algunos tips como para trabajar en el aula, desde lo humano. Después viene lo metodológico, después hacemos que le pase a la escuela. Pero primero es el vínculo con la persona. Un psicomotricista argentino, Daniel Calmels, dice que el organismo habla de la especie y el cuerpo habla de la persona. Cuando nosotros nos conectamos con el cuerpo, con el otro, hecho cuerpo, nos conectamos con la persona y podemos corrernos de la discapacidad. O sea, no llegar al aula y ver una persona en silla de ruedas o ciega, sino que veo a José, a Pedro, a Nazarena, con su historia particular, que además tiene discapacidad. No sé si respondo tu pregunta.
Thank you. May I add to this one as well? In the programs we're implementing with girls with disabilities, We have since 4 years implemented the program called Male Mentors. So we have worked with parents because we believed also the empowerment process and the identity starts at the household. So we have been mainly even focusing on fathers within the households, trying to engage them within the process of understanding the importance of inclusion for their daughters. And that showed its effectiveness, not just in terms of keeping girls from being excluded from the education system, but actually being so much empowered in the system because they have been given the space back home by their parents, by their brothers and sisters, and that worked very well for their inclusion within the classrooms. So again, I think the connection between community, the family, and the education system is key as well based on our experience.
Can I ask a question as well, please?
Yes, we've got one more comment for this current question.
Sí, quería agregar un comentario en relación a lo que dijiste y acá en el lugar de mamá. Hoy cuando les decía que lo primero que se pierde es identidad, desde el psicoanálisis dicen que un hijo viene a compensar el dolor del parto, ¿no? Tenemos a veces 24 horas de parto, nos morimos del dolor, odiamos a nuestro marido. En esas 24 horas juramos que nunca más nos va a tocar y sin embargo, una vez que nace el bebé, nos enamoramos perdidamente y después nos llenamos de hijos. ¿Qué pasa cuando ese bebé no es el que soñabas? ¿No? Cuando el bebé no es el que imaginaste durante los 9 meses de embarazo. Ninguno de nosotros durante el embarazo deseamos tener un hijo con discapacidad. Ninguno de nosotros puede decir se tocó la panza y quería tener un hijo rubio y con parálisis cerebral o morocho y con síndrome de Down. Nadie. En todo caso, una pesadilla puede ser, pero un sueño no. En el momento en que nace un hijo con discapacidad, se muere un proyecto. Y el gran problema para una familia es que con el proyecto se muera el hijo real, ¿no? Porque se muere el hijo que no fue. Y a veces a la escuela no llega un hijo con discapacidad. Ese no es el problema en la escuela. A veces a la escuela llega un muerto en vida. Y tal vez el mayor desafío de la escuela es revincularlo con la familia. Y me parece más que acertado el trabajo con la familia para revincularlo. Y miren la trascendencia de la escuela más allá de las paredes.
Okay, thank you. Who had the question?
Yeah, could I just ask us? As a father of an autistic child, but also as a school leader who's worked in a number of schools where there's an attached unit working with kids with hearing impairment or kids on the spectrum, my question is, what are the risks and benefits of training the other kids in understanding the needs of the SEND child? And how does one avoid that embedding further the labels about which we've been warned today?
Very good question. Would anybody like to take this?
Yeah.
Okay, Ola?
I actually don't see any risks at that because the whole inclusion principle is having children with and without disabilities within the same environment. Uh-huh. And as we know, that stereotype and stigma around disability is inherited in communities. So a few of those children who are non-disabled would come to the classroom with a certain understanding of what disability would look like. So the more we give them the space to interact with their disabled peer in the classroom, but also provide them with the information, I wouldn't say lecturing them. There are always innovative ways of making that interaction happen outside the learning environment, because that will effectively bring that more positively within the learning space as well. What I'm saying is in many schools, for example, unfortunately, because of infrastructure limitations, you can see that students with disabilities are deprived from being engaged in even cooking classes or sports classes or arts classes. This is the space where children usually are more enjoying their space within school, and that is the space where they are more open to interact with each other. So the importance of that is equal to the learning sessions where you can create those spaces, spaces between disabled and non-disabled to learn that they are equal, and disability then dissolves automatically.
And we have another comment as well.
May we may also make a comment on that. This is one of the elements that I mentioned before, reverse inclusion. When you bring children who are, we'll go inverted commas, normal in, to work with our children, where our children take the lead and they showcase their strengths, something quite magical happens there. So reverse inclusion is an interesting area to particularly look at. We had a quick conversation on that, did we not?
Mm-hmm. Indeed. Yes, and we also have to think of the global perspective of life after schooling, and that these children with various disabilities need to be able to adapt to work in the world as it exists now, and to be self-sufficient and independent so that they can get that employment they so badly seek. And because the workplace is probably, well, it should be an inclusive environment, and that's what it should be. Whether it is or not is up for discussion.
And we have time for one more question. We'll take both, because I can see two hands. Yes?
Hola, sí, mi nombre es María Julia y soy periodista de Argentina. Quería preguntarle en particular a Silvana Corso. En una oportunidad, una directora de la ciudad de Buenos Aires, de donde es Silvana, me dijo que ella había tenido un hijo con autismo y que estaba trabajando en una escuela con puertas abiertas. Y se preguntaba, ¿por qué yo, por qué Silvana, a quien ella conoce, por qué vos, Silvana, y otros casos contados, tratan este tema o tienen una escuela en la que se trabaja con la inclusión y por qué no sucede en otros casos cuando no son escuelas que están próximas a la discapacidad? ¿Qué nos está faltando? ¿Y cuál es el alcance? ¿Está sucediendo de manera más abarcativa ahora esto?
Personalmente creo que en realidad todos los que estamos involucrados en temas de discapacidad lamentablemente fuimos tocados, ¿no?, de cerca por alguna situación personal, familiar o de amigos, y eso nos involucra. Y digo lamentablemente desde este lugar, no visibilizamos a las personas con discapacidad. Recién ahora creo están ganando un terreno importante, digo, están ganando la calle, por suerte, y bienvenidos, porque eso nos interpela. Pero hace 20 años atrás, cuando nació mi hija, yo iba por la calle y me sentía que era la única persona que tenía discapacidad. Y cuando visitaba los centros terapéuticos, encontraba cantidad de chicos así. Y me preguntaba qué pasaba con ellos. Como no hay lugar en la sociedad, las familias deciden recluirse, porque no es que a los chicos se recluye también la familia como unidad en estos lugares donde encuentra un igual, ¿no? Y se consuela con eso y bueno, y asume que la sociedad no está preparada. Que empezamos en esto, en realidad en muchas escuelas lo hacen, tal vez es un trabajo más silencioso, yo tuve la oportunidad por el Global Teacher Prize de poder darlo a conocer. Sí, es una escuela que trabaja con un número importante de alumnos con discapacidad que no se da en otros lugares. Hoy, ¿cuál es la situación? Me parece que el discurso está instalado y celebro esta mesa, ¿no? Digo, claramente está instalado. Todos los que vinieron a participar se quedaron porque están interesados en el debate, ¿no? Entonces, me parece que hoy el discurso está instalado. En la Argentina está el exministro, hubo un avance importante con una resolución como la 311 de diciembre, donde un poco nos está interpelando todas las escuelas, ¿no? Ahora la resolución se tiene que hacer carne y la tenemos que vivir todas las escuelas. Hoy estamos obligados, no debería decirlo así, pero es así, estamos obligados. Digo, no debería decirlo así porque es una responsabilidad, no es una obligación. Pero la resolución nos lleva a que abramos las puertas a todos y titulemos como corresponde a todos y cada uno de nuestros alumnos, como una oportunidad, como dije, transformadora, ¿no?, de la sociedad argentina. Yo creo que en relación a 20 años atrás, el debate está instalado, no le es ajeno, no es ajeno a nivel mundial, estamos lejos todavía de hacerlo real y esperemos que trascienda y que no quede en manos de aquellos que vivimos la discapacidad y que todos de alguna manera nos convirtamos en militantes de la discapacidad, más allá de tener o no un allegado con esa condición.
Thank you. I believe Cary wanted to make a comment to that question as well.
Indeed, just a short note. In the educational community, I've noticed in my work over the years that there's a misconception that students with special needs and students with disabilities are perceived by educators, not in every sense, but in many cases, to be less able to perform for whatever reason. And if we truly have an inclusive learning experience, we will discover, as John Patterson to my left has indicated, many miracles will happen. And you pour water on a seed and it will grow. And inspiring students with disabilities to fully participate in an inclusive, equitable learning experience will be rewarding to society as a whole. Thank you.
Thank you. I have a question here. This will be our last question.
Hi, my name is Dari from Mexico. I work in the school as a support teacher for special needs kids. And I think one of the most important things you do is making sure they can access that, you know, knowledge and education, but also for them to be independent. And I want to know, how do you think is the best way for them to access knowledge and be independent without over-supporting them? I think that sometimes, as a supporting teacher, you can not let them be as independent because you want them to access as much knowledge as possible. So how do you think you can, as a school,
if I can answer that from VI, we can answer it together?
Absolutely.
Okay, well for us straight away, mobility is, you've seen plenty of children with the white cane. You'd be surprised how much mobility is not taught around the world. Mm-hmm. Mobility is first, knowing yourself, knowing your boundaries, knowing where you are. That is the start point of building confidence. And once you've got confidence, we can start going over to the things like we talked about, STEM and individuality and creativity.
Indeed, and then to follow up on what John just said, the access to literacy and having a means by which to read, in the case of the visually impaired, I believe every blind and visually impaired child should know how to read and write Braille. Even if they can read large print, there's the perception that Braille is hard and difficult to teach, but in reality, it's the only proven literacy tool for the blind to promote employment and educational opportunities in the history of the world, and I strongly encourage its use widely.
And Ola, did you have a final comment?
Yes, I just want to confirm that the concept of independent living for disability does not exclude assistance. So definitely we know that reasonable accommodation, personal assistance is required for people with disabilities to function. We are not excluding the impairment. We're saying we need to create the environment in a way that the interaction between the individual and the environment is very effective. So coming to your question, creating that environment may entail your support. It's just the assurance that the student is leading that pathway. So you are just a mean for him or her to be effectively learning what you want them to achieve or what they would like to seek within that learning environment, whether it entails physical assistance, accessible materials, you know, visual aid, whatever it is. It's for you first to understand what is the barrier between them and the access to information and trying to create that environment to them. I think that is very key. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So to summarize, it's very clear that where there may be some policy priorities, there needs to be confirmation of a philosophical confirmation and commitment to inclusion to begin the next steps towards considering what that will mean strategically and operationally. But what we've certainly felt today across all four speakers, first of all, policy-wise, there are success stories. Ola has highlighted that. And our three other colleagues have shared very clearly, we're thinking about sometimes strategies, ways of meeting need bridging barriers, but at the core of very successful inclusion is clearly relationships, understanding, and instead of tolerance, it's moving towards acceptance and promoting their independence and understanding of themselves. And it's fantastic to bring that at the center of something that is very much thinking about how to improve access to education, but actually very fundamentally can sit with any of us in this room. It does not require something that may be statutorily defined by government. It is going to come from society to move towards a more inclusive education system. Thank you so much for joining, and also for being so committed towards this topic, which is really crucial as we think about 2030 and the pupils of the future.